shit, the Pentagon!
Where?
The Pentagon!
Oh my God.
This previously unscreened material records the moment on September the 11th last year when the Pentagon in Washington was attacked.
Leave those cameras running!
The unseen cameraman speaks for us all.
Oh my God.
Where were you when the world stopped turning? That September day.
We all know where we were when it happened, and the drama unfolded before our eyes on our screens.
The second one is going down now.
We saw the planes and the burning buildings.
Rising against that blue sky.
And then within hours, speculation and rumor was rife as to how and why and who was behind it. Al-Qaeda and its leader, Osama bin Laden, were soon blamed. But one man, whose books have now become huge bestsellers in his native France, says this is all wrong. The aircraft that flew into the Twin Towers were guided by remote control. The Pentagon was hit by a missile, not a plane. And the perpetrators, not Al-Qaeda, but unnamed people at the very heart of the United States government. Their purpose? To justify an attack on Afghanistan and possibly Iraq too. If true, September the 11th would certainly rank as the mother of all conspiracies. If not, why were the books written and what has made so many people buy them? This is investigative journalist Thierry Maison. His books have sold more than 250,000 copies in 18 languages. In them, he outlines his ideas of what happened last year.
Right from the very start, I had questions about the anomalies and inconsistencies of that day, and so I wanted to understand what had really happened. I believe that everyone saw the two planes fly into the Twin Towers, but on the other hand, there are certain things which no one saw and which are presented as if they were certainties. I explained, for example, that the attack on the Pentagon was not carried out using a Boeing 757.
The impromptu shrines at the scene may be fading, but most people's memories are not, particularly those of the numerous eyewitnesses.
I was stuck in traffic, it wasn't moving. I was frustrated because I was listening to what was going on in New York on the radio and I wanted to get into work. And I'm sitting there and I rolled down the window and that's when I first heard the jet. And I looked up and I saw it as it was banking. And then it came right before me. I mean, it started its decline and slammed right into the Pentagon.
Think of the center of your windshield, and that's where I saw the American Airlines jet come left to right. And then my first thought was, my God, that's not going to make it across the river to National Airport. Didn't even think what it might be doing. And then it slammed into the side of the Pentagon. There was a fireball. Did not come out. It went straight up. And all hell broke loose at that point.
John O'Keefe is a legal journalist. He was also stuck in traffic outside the Pentagon that morning and is convinced he too saw a plane. Not a missile.
All of a sudden, out of the left side of my view, came this giant American Airlines plane. There was no mistaking what type of plane it was. It was a silver jet with American Airlines plastered on the side. And, you know, it looked like a plane coming in for a landing, except that it was going in the wrong direction. It wasn't headed towards the airport. It was too low. It was out of place. It took a few moments before it sort of registered where it was heading, you know, right towards the Pentagon. The next thing I knew, it was a giant explosion, a huge orange ball of fire.
For an investigative journalist, Thierry's methods are unusual. In researching his books, he never left France, nor did he meet or interview any witnesses.
I did not carry out any interviews myself. I collected the interviews that these people had given to the American press. And in addition to this, certain French journalists carried out additional interviews themselves, and so I collected all that material together. I cannot therefore be accused of having manipulated the words of the witnesses.
He's managed to take my words and twist them, not just on one occasion, but two. I just read the excerpts here, and if it wasn't so sad and so sick, it'd all be laughable. You know, it's so absurd, but it is sick.
It's sort of despicable to try to sell books on the misery of others and with this kind of misinformation. I'll tell you unequivocally, it was an American Airlines jet, and I have no other reason for telling you that other than you're coming to me and asking.
There is a saying, oddly enough, it's originally a French saying, of a man, he lies like an eyewitness. And everyone has known of abrupt reversals of fortune in court when the apparently unbreakable testimony of an eyewitness turns out to have been false, though believed in by the witness himself or herself. But if you can collectivize eyewitnessing, if you can find a number of people with no connection with each other, and they all agree, that's more than eyewitness, I think.
How can Thierry be so sure that all the witnesses are wrong, individually and collectively? It all boils down to this photograph. This is a photograph of the façade just after the attack. We are told that the aeroplane entered the building just here. The information is very precise. If we enlarge the image, we can see that the aeroplane actually entered through this door without damaging the surrounds. That a Boeing 757, an aircraft with a wingspan of 38 meters and with a tail elevation of 12 meters, entered the Pentagon without leaving any impact marks on the facade of the building, I do not see how anyone can believe such nonsense. You do not need to have studied ballistics to know that an aeroplane cannot pass through a door. So is Thierry right? Could an aeroplane really pass through this hole in the Pentagon's outer wall, as the official version would have us believe? We asked Alex Standish what he thinks. Alex is editor of Jane's Intelligence Digest, a highly respected journal of geopolitical and strategic intelligence. He's also an expert on aluminium.
An aircraft is primarily made of aluminium alloy. This is a strong material, but clearly not as strong as the walls of the Pentagon. The external wall is about 2 feet thick. It's made of concrete, limestone, brick, steel, and it has a Kevlar lining, which is incredibly strong. So you don't get the print of the wings simply because the wings have been folded in. We have to remember that the fuselage of the cabin is only about 10.5 feet on a Boeing 757, and it would have fitted through there. It would have been compressed as it went through, and the wings would have been drawn inward.
Why no sign of where the tail hit?
Well, the tail on a Boeing 757 is about 36 feet high. But again, it's aluminium, it's not a particularly substantial construction. So what would have happened is the plane would have gone in, the tail would have been broken off, or have been forced downward, and the plane would have continued on through the building with the tail fin down and the wings compressed.
These CCTV images are the only known pictures of the moment of impact. They don't, however, show what caused the explosion, which is usually attributed to flight AA-77. Thierry says it wasn't an American Airlines Boeing at all. So what does he think happened to the plane?
I have no idea what happened to Flight 77.
Did Flight 77 exist?
Of course.
If Flight 77 existed, where is it?
Listen, it's not up to me to answer that kind of question. It's up to the American government to explain itself. The Civil Aviation Authority's explanation that this plane crashed over Ohio was widely reported in the press, and Vice President Cheney himself had to come forward to deny that fact. And so it's up to them to explain their own contradictions.
Where are all the passengers on Flight 77?
They have disappeared. and are probably dead, since the aircraft appears to have been destroyed.
America is a big place, but you don't just lose an aeroplane.
No, it is perfectly possible to lose an aircraft over a national park on the borders of Ohio and West Virginia. There would be no witnesses to the destruction of the plane.
And where does Alex Standish think the plane is?
This is not like looking at a plane crash which has taken place in an open field, where, for example, the pilot typically will have tried to have saved the plane. This was something which was designed to destroy the plane and to destroy the building. And therefore, as the plane penetrated the building and exploded, as the aviation fuel ignited, you have this enormous explosion in a confined space, and the plane itself was completely destroyed.
Thierry would have us believe that the Pentagon was hit by a missile. And as for flight AA-77, it was lost somewhere in Ohio. He also writes that the World Trade Center planes were operated by remote control from the ground. So who then does he believe perpetrated this complex and unlikely conspiracy?
I simply have a certain number of theories, and I note that the only credible theory at present is that responsibility lies with the military-industrial complex. I think that the people who were in the position to do this were people who were on the inside of the American state apparatus. So I conclude that the military-industrial lobby wished to launch what is called the Star Wars Division, an absolutely huge military program, and that during his campaign, President Bush committed himself to supporting this. Once he had been appointed President of the United States, he no longer wanted to support this because it was too expensive and it was useless. So it was necessary to force the President's hand.
Was President Bush a conspirator?
Listen, I cannot answer such a question. I have no accusations to lay against President Bush, but I do have some questions to ask him. Now, Bush thinks that this plot could only have been organized by foreigners and probably by Arabs. What I have determined in my inquiry is that there is nothing to prove to us that the real culprits are the people who have been named as the guilty parties. The consequence of this is, of course, that there is no legitimacy to the American response in Afghanistan or to the response in Iraq, which is now forecast.
You start with a premise that the U.S. government has no legitimacy and is engaged in all sorts of evil acts, and you look historically at the fact that there are times when the U.S. government has been a bully, has engaged in covert action, and then what you do is you just basically take that and say, if it happened before, it has to have happened now. And it's that kind of conspiracy theory that's written backwards. You have your enemy, you have your target, the United States government and the CIA and all these, you know, evildoers, and you have this story of some traumatic event that's horrifying, and you just put it together and say they have to be connected somehow.
There is a method, it's most simply expressed by Bertrand Russell, of using the balance of evidence against interest. In other words, if the Pope says he believes in God, he's only doing his job. If the Pope says he doesn't believe in God, it's quite likely he's onto something. If the United States suddenly finds itself committed in a place like Afghanistan, the last place God made, it's, I think, going to be extraordinarily difficult to show that it wanted to be there so much that it was prepared to shoot itself, not in the foot, but very near the heart and very near the brain, in order to have the privilege of being there. Where is the interest that would require such a self-mutilation? And how can you show that the same objective could not have been achieved more simply and at less cost? On all those tests, Monsieur Nassin's work is hopelessly compromised.
Where were you when the world stopped turning on that September day?
To most of us, Thierry Masson's theories are surely palpable nonsense. But his books have already made more than £600,000 profit, and English language versions are now hot off the press. Why is it then that so many people are willing to buy into these conspiracy theories, however far-fetched?
Where were you when the world stopped turning?
For a previous generation, the world stopped turning once before. On a bright November day in 1963, when John Kennedy was shot by a lone gunman in Dallas. Or maybe not. For nearly 40 years, Kennedy's assassination has been the subject of scores of theories. Were the Russians involved? The Mafia? Who was behind the grassy knoll?
Well, the comparison with the Kennedy assassination illustrates the difference between now and then. In the days of the Kennedy assassination, it took 2 years, maybe 3 years, before the skeptics of the official version got underway, got magazines to publish articles, got editors to publish books. In the internet age, 9-1-1, the conspiracy theories began appearing the same day. And I began receiving them on my little computer the next day.
Today, if you type 9-11 conspiracy into your computer, you'll find more than 68,000 documents. They range from the wild and wacky to serious academic analyses. What they have in common with each other and other conspiracy theories, be they the Kennedy assassination, Diana's car crash, or Martin Luther King's death in Memphis, is that they try to give us neat answers to the unanswered and sometimes unanswerable questions that surround such tragedies.
When people see some horrible event that's very dramatic and they're shocked, they often try and find some greater meaning in it. And they want to reject the idea that it's random, that it was not stoppable. They want to see some pattern. And the brain wants to categorize things. And so when somebody comes along and says, there's no mystery here, A, B, C, D, E, connect the dots, you can see what really happened. People think, well, that's a very persuasive idea, and it makes me understand the event and make me feel better about there being some control in the world.
There is always an official version, and there's usually a very good reason to be skeptical of it. So the person who will say, well, the emperor has no clothes, we should be grateful to such people, but they have a responsibility in their turn to set a high standard of the pursuit of evidence and to show some respect for the three concepts of motive, method, and opportunity in making allegations of official collusion.
Thierry Messon's theory that it was Americans and not Al-Qaeda who attacked the United States last year does not survive even the most elementary tests of motive, method, and opportunity. But conspiracy theorists like Thierry thrive in the holes that inevitably occur in the official version of major tragedies. And with September the 11th, as with Kennedy, there are real holes, even for those who don't believe Thierry's version of events. Both at the Twin Towers and the Pentagon, the hijacked planes exploded on impact, reaching temperatures in excess of 1300 degrees centigrade. Flesh, bone, steel and aluminium were mostly evaporated or incinerated. Yet a few days later, the FBI announced that the passport of an unnamed hijacker survived the inferno and was subsequently found close to ground zero.
Well, I think one is led to suspect that perhaps that was not part of the original debris. I'm very sceptical about that claim.
Hang on a second, Alex. You're the editor of Jane's Intelligence. You are alleging that someone planted a crucial piece of evidence at a crime site.
It's always possible. It's happened in the past. I would say it's highly unlikely that that sort of identifiable document would have conveniently been found in the location that it was. Certainly, I think there are elements of the story which do not stand up to serious scrutiny.
The discovery of the passport was trumpeted at the time by FBI Assistant Director Barry Morn. But now the FBI says the discovery of the passport is just a rumor, which may be a fact. In other words, now they won't tell us if it was really found or not. And there's one more potentially disturbing piece in this incomplete jigsaw. There was, of course, a fourth hijacked plane that day, flight UA-93, carrying 44 people from Newark to San Francisco, crashed in Pennsylvania before it could reach its supposed target in Washington. The official version is that a number of heroic passengers stormed the hijacked cockpit and sacrificed their lives to prevent an even worse catastrophe.
Certainly the official version that the passengers attempted to take control of the plane back from the hijackers, that the pilots had probably been killed by that point, and that they lost control and the plane was subsequently as it crash-landed and destroyed. I think there are important questions to be raised there. One is that I think there is some evidence that there were people on board who had sufficient experience to regain control. And indeed, I think there is some evidence they may have done so.
If the plane was perhaps being flown by the passengers rather than the hijackers when it crashed, what really happened in its last moments? When the plane crashed, most of its fuselage, passengers and crew were reduced to tiny fragments around this site in what used to be a forgotten corner of Pennsylvania. Strangely, a single one-ton piece of engine was found intact more than a mile away, and other remains more than 2 miles away. So how did they come to rest so far from the remainder of the plane? Could it perhaps have been destroyed while still in the air?
The question which arises is whether, in view of the previous three incidents, whether the United States Air Force shot down Flight 93. Now, one can understand why that decision may have been taken. I mean, if this plane was genuinely being aimed at Congress or the White House, then the question would have to be asked. Was it appropriate to shoot it down? Many people, I think, would have said yes, but not if control had already been regained. And I think that that is the question which could only be settled, and I think it should be settled, by a proper independent investigation looking at issues such as the flight recorder. Certainly, I think the issue of the black box and why it's not been released, I think that raises an important question.
The FBI has UA-93's black box flight recorder and says it has played the entire contents to the relatives in private. So private that the families were even forbidden to take notes. But why won't the FBI release the full transcript to independent experts, better equipped to judge what really happened in those crucial final moments? The FBI says it's because there may one day be a criminal trial, but for the moment, this lack of openness leaves them vulnerable to accusations of cover-up. In the meantime, we do know that Air Force jets were scrambled that morning with orders to shoot down rogue airliners, and that at least one F-16 was less than 10 minutes flying time from UA-93. In the absence of official candor, all we have is speculation and a sense of loss.
He said, "I know we're not going to make it out of here." And so she said, "I will stay on the line." And she heard him put the phone down, and that's when she heard him say the last thing she heard him say, and that was, "Are you guys ready? Let's roll." And she heard some commotion after that, and the line went dead sooner after.
I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran.
It all began on a balmy September day a year ago, when 3,055 souls perished in the worst single act of terror anywhere, anytime. The tragedy overwhelmed and shocked us on this day that war came to America's shores.
Where were you when the world stopped turning?
Yet for reasons understandable or otherwise, the full story is still to emerge. And it's in the gaps and crevices between truth that half-truths and lies emerge, leading in turn to allegations of conspiracy and cover-up. In a democracy, these too have a value insofar as they question the received, the official version. Yet the conspiracy theorists also have a responsibility, a duty to shine a light towards truth, not to obscure it. And in our search for truth, the Mesa conspiracy should anger us. Not because it's a conspiracy theory, simply because it's a poor one, which is all too easily disproved.
Did you lay down at night, think of tomorrow, go out?
War's one-year on-season continues with the definitive account of the events of September the 11th, made mostly from amateur video and still photographs, and with the recollections of Mayor Giuliani. In Memoriam, New York City is tomorrow at 9 o'clock.